judging by who I see online and in the room, apparently Monday, January 4th has been declared Youth Night at I-CODA. Nobody told me. You gotta tell me these things. Greetings to all the youth. We love the youth. And spirituality is a young person's game. More than any other age bracket. However, it is not the game of youth. The people I see tonight, who I'm referring to as youth, don't take it as a criticism. That's too young. That is not the age bracket, typically. When I say the spiritual game is a game for the young, I'm talking about 30 to 50. So, well, let's say 25 to 50. 25 to 50. That's the statistical average. So, if you're under 25 or under, and you have the slightest spiritual interest, if you can attend a meeting like this, if you have read a spiritual book more than one that's not on the bestseller list, if you read one and it's from the bestseller list, doesn't count. But if you've read a book or more than a book that is not on the bestseller list that's in the spiritual category, or if you ponder spiritual questions beyond adolescence, after the age of 19, you are in a tiny, tiny, extraordinary minority. Extraordinary because it's almost impossible. There are a billion others. Not quite, but almost a billion others exactly like you for whom it is not even remotely possible. And then there are these few, you few, who are in that category. And it is the smallest category there is of people who have any spiritual interest. You are the smallest minority in spiritual whatever. Anything can be called spiritual. You are the tiniest minority. 15 to 25. All the cards are stacked against you. There should almost be no way that this could be going on. All the forces argue against it. All the influences are in a different direction. The fact that you could be in that situation under 25 is next to impossible, yet there you are. So you should understand that you are an anomaly. You are not the exception to the rule. There's so few of you that you can't be called an exception, because any rule has usually a number of exceptions. You're not the exception, you're the impossibility that actually has happened anyway. And it can only be phenomenally confusing for you. Because no other age bracket has so much coming at it that says, this is crazy, don't do this, this is a mistake, this will have a bad end, you are being not right, you should do something different, you should have a different interest, you should read a different book, you should go to a different lecture, a different meeting, a different event. The pressure on you to not do this is greater than it is on any other person of any different age. So it's even more amazing that nevertheless you read those books, nevertheless you ponder these questions, nevertheless you go to a meeting like this, nevertheless you pursue your spiritual interest to whatever degree, more or less, you do. You should understand that you are doing it against all the odds, and that any confusion you feel and any negativity that comes at you for it is to be expected. There is no way for it to be otherwise, because you do not yet, under 25, have enough life experience to be able to sort things out in any reasonable way. Just being under 25 is confusing by itself. You may not feel confused, but you are in a confused situation because you do not have the benefit of wider experience, more different kinds of experiences. So you are at a kind of a disadvantage. Time will take care of it. You will get older, you'll have more experiences. Even if you've had more experiences by 25 than the average, it's not enough yet. And then to lay on top of it the question of spirituality and what all that means, and the profound questions of life, which are totally spiritual questions. What's a human being? Who am I? What's life? What's death? What's it all about? What's the purpose of life? Is there God? What does it all mean? There are people who, after the age of 14, never ask themselves these questions ever again, and live 80, 90 years and die never having pondered it after it occurred to them for a short while at 13, 14, 15. Everybody thinks about these things at that age. But it usually doesn't go beyond that for the vast majority of people. But for you to be able to have any kind of spiritual pursuit under 25 is just amazing. You really should see yourself not in an ego way, not in an oh I'm so great way, in a simply factual way as I'm amazing. I'm doing something and interested in something and involved with something, and concerned with something, that almost no one else at my age ever is. Just, whether it's good or bad, it's extraordinary. And of course it's good. So you should give yourself, not in a I'm so hot stuff way, but simply in a recognition way, this is something really amazing, and I am very, very lucky. I am very, very not the common kid. You should recognize that you are in a different bracket, in a different category, in a different kind of life. And it is unlikely, whether you take this as good news or bad news, you should as quick as possible recognize that it is unlikely that you will ever fit with the majority. And you should as quickly and as much as you can give up trying to fit with the majority because the majority way is not for you. You were born for a different way, a minority way, a higher road, a bigger destination. And remember, the rarity of it is what makes it extraordinary. It's not because you're so great. You are, but that's not why. It's because it's so rare. Anything that's rare is extraordinary. Even if it's rare and terrible, it's still extraordinary because of its rarity. Anything super rare is extraordinary. So, you are more rare than dogs that can talk. And I'm not making a joke. There are more dogs on earth who have the ability to be taught to talk, to say words, to be able to say hello, Harold, how are you? There are more dogs that can be taught that than there are under 25 sincere spiritual seekers. The rarity means that you have to accept for your own good that you are not going to have certain things ever in common with the majority, with those who are more conventional, with those who do not have your ability to think for yourself. The distinguishing ability of one who is under 25 and spiritually interested. The main thing that's different is you have the ability, unlike most others, to think for yourself. I've said this before about people in general. I'm going to repeat it because it fits here. It's very hard to grasp. The natural tendency is to reject it as soon as you hear it because it sounds harsh, it sounds critical, it sounds unfair. That's the absolute truth. And you won't necessarily see the evidence of it. You're just going to have to take my word for it that it's so. The evidence is overwhelming, but that doesn't mean we all see it. The average person, the majority of people, do not have any ability during their lifetime to think for themselves. The average person is born, lives, and dies, never having experienced a single original, keyword original, a single original thought. They have never had a thought that was purely from their own experience, their own knowing, their own wisdom, and their own creativity, and their own selfhood. Every thought they have is influenced by something they heard, were told, read, saw on TV, their mother said 50 years ago, their father said 40 years ago, their brother said when they were five. They have thoughts that when they say them may sound kind of original, but they're not. They never have a single thought that purely comes from themselves and nowhere and nothing else. It's actually original. The majority of people do not have the capacity and then are societally trained to definitely not have the capacity for original thinking. Having your own idea about something that is not coming from what lots of other people think or what lots of other sources say. But if you're under 25 and you are spiritually inclined or take the idea of spirituality in any way seriously or can come to a meeting like this or have even a quite active spiritual pursuit, one thing is for sure, you have the ability and are thinking for yourself. What you probably don't know is very few other people do that. Most of the people you meet, interact with, see every day in life have never had an original thought. Even intelligent people. It's not a question of IQ. It's not a question of how smart you are or how not smart you are. It's a question of capacity to think for yourself without any unconscious outside influence determining or being the origin of that thought or that idea or that feeling. So it's a hard pill to swallow, I know, when people hear this for the first time, because it sounds like I'm saying something terrible, but I'm not. It'd be like saying the majority of people have either brown eyes or blue eyes. That's factually so. If you say all brown-eyed people plus all blue-eyed people, you've covered the majority of people. The majority of people have never had an original thought. It's not a criticism. It's not an insult. The majority of people have either brown or blue eyes. Is that an insult? Is that being critical? It's factually so. But because it's not generally recognized, and almost the only place you'll hear it is from some guru type, it sounds a little way out there. But it's not. What's important about it is that you recognize, and now we're talking about all spiritual seekers, that you cannot go into, but it's more extraordinary if you're under 25, is that you cannot go into more than a passing acquaintance with spirituality, spiritual life, spiritual principles. You cannot explore spiritually in any real and meaningful way if you are not capable of original thinking. So the vast majority of spiritual seekers, people who have definitive spiritual interests in life, that's simply proof that they absolutely can think for themselves. They absolutely are capable of original thinking. The vast majority of people otherwise are not. Has nothing to do with how smart you are or aren't. Has nothing to do with whether you went to school or how far you went. Has to do with your innate way of experiencing life, and are you able to think for yourself for real without any exterior influence being the main source of that thought? And of course, nobody's going to agree with this, because if you say to someone, guess what, you've never had an original thought, you think they're going to say, oh yeah, come to think of it, you're right. They're going to be offended, they're going to argue with you, and they're going to say, you're nuts, of course I can think for myself. I don't wear Ralph Lauren clothes because of advertising. I like Ralph Lauren clothes. Everybody thinks they're original. Everybody thinks they're having original thoughts. And everybody thinks that they are only minimally influenced from the outside. And the vast majority are simply not correct in that view. That's also part of not being able to think originally. Because the societal influence is you're all individuals and you all have to think for yourselves, which is a coded message for do what the herd does, go with the majority. It's very tricky. So of course you can't go around saying in meetings publicly or in any forum, you can't say, well, most people never have had an original thought. You'll have stuff thrown at you. Which is why we check everybody when you come in. If you're carrying some tomatoes, we take them away. So if you're under 25, you will, like most of us, try to fit in all kinds of places with all kinds of people. And while in some ways at some times that will be right and good, there'll be many times when it's just never going to happen and you'll be batting your head against the wall. So you should develop a little bit of good judgment, a little bit of discernment of when you're really in a position or in a situation where you shouldn't bother, where it is not important for you to fit in. Because why would you want to fit in with people who can't think for themselves? Why would you want to fit in with people who are simply following the herd? Why would you want to fit in with people who will not accept you as you are? You are not going to succeed when that's the case. And there'll be a lot of wear and tear the more you try. And I certainly am absolutely the poster boy for this, because the first 30 years of my life, I spent almost all my energy trying to fit in ways that I would never be able to, in ways that, now with the wisdom of age, I would never want to. But boy, did I have a lot of heartache and a lot of wasted energy trying to fit in with people I didn't even like and who couldn't ever be a satisfying milieu for me. And yet, that's our training, to fit in. Took me a long time, and the hard way to figure out that I can't do it, but even more importantly, that I shouldn't do it, and that even better, I'm glad it's that way. And when I see somebody younger, under 25, who's spiritually inclined, that's what goes on inside me, is I really feel bad for them, because I know they're going to try to do what I did, at least in some situations, and I know they're going to fail, which is good, but it'll still hurt. And you'll still go through the judgments, like, what's wrong with me? And nothing's wrong with you. You're just cut from a different cloth. You're just a better version than all the others. Because if you can think for yourself, you're better. It's not a value judgment. It means you have an extraordinary ability that the majority of people don't have. If you can jump 20 feet in the air, and hardly anybody else on the whole planet can, you're better when it comes to jumping. That's not saying anything against the rest of us who can't jump. You should recognize that you have an extraordinary ability, an extraordinary skill, a capacity that the majority of people of any and every age don't have. And it has led you, guided you, taken you into the most important thing possible for any human being. It's taken you to the door of spirituality, which is the only door that will make any real difference in the most important and meaningful way. So don't do what I did and judge yourself as not good enough because you don't fit in. Be really glad that it's so. Be really happy that you're not like everyone else. If you were, you'd be very poor. Instead, you have the wealth, the richness of being able to think originally for yourself. Good for you. It's a gift you were born with. You didn't do anything for it. You just have that capacity. But it's so lucky. You will only be aware of how lucky it is as you get older and older and older. Until then, just take my word for it. Now, I was born capable of original thinking, but I was not capable of under 25 recognizing the spiritual nature of things. So that's why I call you extraordinary. It's not particularly extraordinary to be able to think for yourself. There are plenty of people who can, not the majority, but there are very few who under 25 can think for themselves and be spiritually aware to any degree. So just understand your minority status and the fact that it is absolutely in your favor and will lead to really good things down the road. Another problem is you want them now. They won't happen now. It's down the road. Now is the preparation. Now is the moving in that direction. But you won't get the results till after your early 30s. That's the earliest. The real benefits won't arrive. So you have to be a little patient, at least till about 31, 32, 33. That's my pep talk for the youth. Okay, that's all I'm going to say on that subject. What do you want to talk about? There's about 20 folks online, so don't make me wait.
Yogi Raj.
Well, first Henry, and then Yogi Raj.
When I met with you
on Sunday, you were talking about the...
You can just sit normal. You don't have to leave. The mic is geared to pick you up.
Well, okay. You were talking about the two different paths of yoga. There's the...
Not of yoga.
Or of spiritual life.
Yeah.
And you were saying that there's the path of love, and then there's a path of knowledge and wisdom.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm wondering if you can elaborate more on the path of love, which I myself am a little less adept at.
Well, I've done it many times, and we just recently had a whole intensive mini course on Secrets of the Devotional Path, part one, and we're about to start part two. But since you ask, what do you most want to know about it?
Well, I guess I don't really understand it. So I know there's, I think it's different than like sexual love. It's not like, it's devotional. It's not like necessarily based on a male-female relationship depending on your orientation, you know, physical.
It's not based on romance, yes.
Yeah.
Romantic love or romantic relating is not what we're talking about when we say the devotional path or the path of love.
Right. So then, how does it work? Because I feel like in our culture, we're traditionally programmed to think about something that's associated with love as being, you know, a force of sexual attraction. So I'm just wondering if you can recontextualize it for people like me.
Well, if you're a man in this culture, if you're a woman, that's not how you think of love.
Mm-hmm.
They have a different conditioning and a different programming, equally nuts.
Mm-hmm.
So it works. The love path works exactly like romance. Romance actually exists because it's a shadowy representation, very watered down, very far removed but still reflective of the love path. So it works just like romance. In other words, what's the devotional path? What's the love path? It's the path of falling in love. So either you fall in love with the guru, or you fall in love with God, or you fall in love with the notion of universality, or you fall in love with the notion of all are one. So whatever it is, it's about falling in love with it more and more and more. Mm-hmm. So love becomes the method. Now, what happens when you fall in love romantically? If you're a man, you fall in love with a woman. If you're a woman, you fall in love with a man. What happens? You more, and what happens is, it's progressive. If you allow it, you start falling in love more. You're more in love this month than you were. If you say, I'm in love with so-and-so, and it's a romantic relationship, this month, you'll say, I'm definitely more in love with her than I was last month. Until you get to a certain point where your feeling is, wow, I am head over heels. I am maximally in love. I know I can fall more in love, but I can't imagine what that would feel like. Because now you're in a kind of a euphoria over it. You're kind of lost in love. You're kind of carried away. And what are you doing? More of your minutes of the day, you're thinking about that person. More than you are wanting to find or do things that will make you happy, you're thinking about what's going to make her happy. And that makes you more happy than doing the things that make you happy. You would rather do what makes her happy because that makes you more happy than when you do the things that make you happy. Mm-hmm. So all of those processes are going on, all of those activities are going on, all of those attitudes are going on, more and more and more. And it's exactly the same in the spiritual sphere of things. So that love becomes what takes you forward spiritually. You, in essence, when you fall in love, in a romantic, worldly sense, you are more and more surrendering to the other person. They become more important to you than yourself. You want their welfare more than you care about your welfare. That's a kind of surrender. Mm. So really, falling in love romantically is a preparation for the higher, deeper, real surrender. So it's the same. The process is the same. The experiencing is the same. But the object of love is different, and the intention of it is different. You're not trying to get, in the romantic love, you're trying to cement the relationship and keep it going. You want to have it forever is your idea when you're in love. Of course, the moment you're out of love, you wonder what the hell you were thinking. But on the love path, it's the same operations going on. You're moving for the same reasons in the same way. You want to give your whole life to the one you love when you're really madly in love, and spiritually you want to give your whole life when you're in love in the love pathway, whether it's to your spiritual master, whether it's to God, whether it's to the religion, whatever it is for you. It's really, really very, very similar in how it works. Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of like romantic love could be a training.
It is. If you've never been deeply in love romantically, and you, for whatever reason, because you were born with that tendency, you are a love path person. Some people are just born with more. That's their natural direction. You're at a disadvantage because you don't know enough about love in the ordinary sense to inform your movement on the love path. It'll kind of be surprising to you. You'll have experiences. You'll have the disadvantage of having experiences that are brand new to you, whereas if you've been in love romantically for real, it's not so new to you. You know what it feels like. You know what happens. Mm-hmm.
But also I think that one distinction is with the romantic love, it can be a form of attachment that is detrimental, whereas...
Romantic love is delusional. Because the idea that happens when you're romantically in love is that it's you're trying to keep it the way it is when it's at its best, which is always in the beginning. You're trying to keep it that way forever. So the cultural delusion, what society teaches you, is that's the way it should be. Everybody lives happily ever after, and you should go with that. And it can't ever be true, because nothing stays the same endlessly. So the idea that your romantic love, when it's at its height of romanticness, at its height of being carried away and you see stars in your eyes, that won't last. However, it can certainly mature, it can certainly metamorphosize into the next level of relationship. And you can be in love with the same person, even as a partner, for your whole life, but it will not be the same experience of love forever, your whole life. It'll be different kinds of love that happen. And in the end, for really successful, long, life-lasting marriages that are fulfilling, it's because at a certain stage, you become deep, deep friends in the highest way that friendship can be. And that's what sustains a real marriage.
Mm-hmm. I'm just wondering, so if you want to approach that kind of a path of love, do you have to take on more of a passive approach? Because
not passive, just understanding that the love path means you are trying to be more and more receptive.
Right, but you also have to kind of let go of your own way and your own technique of doing things, because things start happening to you more so than you start forcing things to happen.
If you can make yourself gently without turning yourself inside out, if you can just progressively make yourself successfully, if you can succeed at making yourself more and more receptive, what you're talking about will take care of itself.
Mm-hmm.
So it isn't about giving up your will. It isn't about doing what the guru says. It isn't about becoming passive. It's about opening, being more willing to open yourself so that you can receive. Mm-hmm. And what you receive will be felt as it grows you. It makes you more. It helps you. And when you see that, you naturally trust more. You naturally feel rightly this is a good thing, and you relax more, and then you actually become less willful, less insistent on your way, because you see his way, her way may actually be better for me than my way.
Yeah.
But not because you're forcing yourself, because you can wisely see it so. And only if you see it so.
So
in other words, blind faith is not a good idea.
Mm-hmm.
It should be faith based on true results that are good.
Mm-hmm. So is the process or the growth that takes place, is that more energetically, or is it more like awareness based? Like you become more aware of... You know, the openness is more like an awareness.
It's energetic, and anything that's energetic will increase your awareness.
Okay, that makes sense.
It always makes sense. Not because I say so, but that's the single most often piece of feedback I get when I talk to people is they say, that makes sense. Which is amazing, because I'm never trying to make sense. If anything, I'm trying to get you to stop insisting that things make sense.
Okay, thank you.
Now, in your case, you are absolutely established on the knowledge path that has been your way at your tender age. And it is more than extraordinary. If you were 60, in fact, many people have sat there who are 60, who are on the knowledge path, and they've been on the knowledge path their whole life. And generally, that person, talking about the 60-year-old, 50-year-old, 70-year-old, whatever, generally, it would be next to impossible for that person to say what you're saying. Generally, they would not be asking about the love path. Generally, they would have a certain closed-mindedness about the possible benefits or that there's anything to understand that might be useful about that entirely different way. So the fact that someone who is clearly and successfully treading the knowledge path to also be to the degree that you obviously are open to and curious about the love path, let me just tell you, you're the only one I've ever met. And I've met a lot of people, and I'm 140 years old.
I didn't realize that.
Yeah, in Jew years. So I've told you before, you blow my mind. Now I'm filling in the blanks of why and how you blow. What are some of the reasons you blow my mind? This is one of the main ones. You have, and it's part of how much you are rightly using the wisdom path. What is super wise? Super wise would be to be open to anything and everything experimentally, to be willing to consider any position or any premise. Now, people on the knowledge path, even very wise ones, usually can't get to that level of open-mindedness. Yet somehow, you know, in Jew years I'm 140, in Jew years you're 6. So somehow at 6, you have gotten to this type of open-mindedness. You are not one in a million, you are one in a billion. It's not a compliment. It's a statement about how rare what's going on in you is. So you are guaranteed, I've never said this to anyone else, you're guaranteed of success. You cannot fail. No matter what goes wrong or how horrible things happen at some point, in the end, you will succeed. Spiritually, you will get to the right place, guaranteed. May take a few years, may take the rest of your life. I don't know how long it will take, I don't care. But you should have a confidence that few people deserve to have. You should see yourself as guaranteed of success eventually. I know your future, and I don't mind telling you, you are assured.
Thank you.
Unfortunately, your mind, your ego will take it as a compliment. Fortunately, your higher self will understand that it's just a statement about your future that I can see clearly. If you can find a way to let it help you by being confident when you ordinarily might not be, or not get frustrated when you ordinarily might, or not feel overly discouraged when it's impossible not to feel discouraged, then that will be using what I'm saying rightly. If you use it to tell yourself, I'm hot stuff, that won't help you.
Well, I'm usually my own toughest critic. So.
Yeah, that's why I say it to you. I wouldn't necessarily say it to anybody. It can be said to with you. I don't have to worry. I just want to participate to the greatest degree you'll let me. I want to support you 1,000%. I want to ride your coattails. I want to see you take off.
Thanks.
You're welcome.
All right.
No matter what happens in your life, no matter who meets you or what they think of you, I guarantee you, out of your whole life, I'm your biggest fan and always will be. You'll never have a bigger fan than me because I can see your future. Do you have a Yogi Raj?
Over the vacation, I took sannyas with Osho at the Osho Dhamma. With Swami Shiv Prajit and his wife as well. I forgot her name. But she was very vibrant.
In what city?
It's in Delhi.
In Delhi, okay.
Outskirts, yeah.
So you've been an initiated disciple of Osho for how many days?
I forgot.
2 weeks, a month?
Oh, about a week and a half.
About a week and a half. So how do you like it?
Yeah, I mean, it's... I felt the hara more. Which is something that I never really felt. I have before when I was consciously looking for it, but otherwise...
You felt your center, your core energy, your core being.
I thought I would feel the heart, but I didn't. I was feeling that hara point the whole time.
That's better.
Yeah. I know
that's superior. Any fool can feel the heart. Good.
Yeah, I'm not trying to figure out why the hara, but I just kind of left it.
Because Osho's a powerful guru, and he took you right to your center, the center of your being.
I feel like it was almost beneficial for me to have both of you, because I sometimes my mind tries to seize both of you at once, and it's like, but physically, so it's like, oh, which one? If I needed to focus on one to get one pointedness, but then it's like the deeper parts, like there's no difference between them. So it kind of forces me to drop the form being attached to the physical form. And if I didn't have a second one, it might fall into that trap later.
Well, if you need to focus on one, I can't see why that would be necessary, but if you really ever feel like it's important and you need to focus on one, Osho or me, focus on me. You understand why? Because when you focus on Osho, you get Osho, you get the greatest master who ever lived. But when you focus on me, you get me and you get my master, who is Osho. So why not get a twofer? Why not get two for the price of one?
Okay.
When you focus on Osho, you don't get me. You get Osho, and you can't lose. But if you have a choice, and it can only be one, focus on me, because then you'll get both.
Mm-hmm. That's how I see it, yeah. Without the focus part in general. Because I know that you live in Osho, so there's no separateness, so I'm creating that... Anyway, yeah, that was the sannyas news, but I wanted to share something else that was a bit not so exciting.
Well, remind me that I owe you a sannyas present. next time I see you physically.
Okay. Were you purposefully like waiting to give everybody the meditation, or because I wasn't sure. I don't mind waiting, but I didn't know if you were waiting to give everybody at once or.
It's not a trick. It's been hard to get to it.
Okay. I was just wondering if you forgot or
something. Something always comes up that has to be done right now when I think, oh, today I'm going to sit down and do that, so.
That's okay. I've been doing the Osho Dynamic Meditation. It's for the first time.
For the first time? Wow.
Well, I did it a few times before, like sparsely, but now I'm doing it, going to do it continuously. It's really good for the modern mind. Especially my mind, because it's young, so it's bombarded with so much stuff.
It's good for everybody under the age of 140, yeah.
Yeah.
That's why I don't do it. But when I did it, it was amazing.
Yeah. Definitely. It's like a shortcut.
It has a lot of benefit. Yeah. It has many different benefits built in.
Mm-hmm. But I had a pretty good trip, apart from that I had seen Osho-dham. I had gone there. And I also went to Ramana Maharishi's ashram in the south with just my mom, because everybody else wanted to stay back. That was also very fascinating. We were there for two and a half days. I climbed the mountain.
Well, since he was the silent saint, it's a good thing he's dead, because your mom would have talked his ear off.
Actually, she was surprisingly able to actually have a couple of spiritual feelings there, which was... That's how powerful the place is. That, you know...
It even silenced her.
It was really fascinating. You know, they had the room where he took Mahasamadhi, where he died, and eight other people who also had that in other areas, and the room where he gave discourse sometimes.
And darshan, yeah.
Yeah, where it's become a meditation room. His bed is still there with the railing around it. This fascinating thing happened to me, but I don't want to take up time to,
It's too late for that.
So on the day I got there, I wanted those like loose pants because it was hot. So I went down the road to see if there was any, but there weren't. So I just bought that cloth you wear around your waist. And a big fat mala, but not long. This is just for fun.
Yeah.
And I put all that on and we went. And when it's like, you know, the enclosure, and then inside there's another temple, and inside that temple there's some sanctum. We had no clue. And there's this really long line. It would have taken an hour or more to get to that little sanctum. And this guy just walks up and sees me and my mom, and he's like, "Oh, Swamiji, Swamiji." He opens the barricade on the side of the line and puts me in.
Well, now I know what to wear when I go.
I told him, you know, that's my mom's. Can she come? And then he's like, "Oh, auntie, auntie," and he calls her in. And my mom had earlier said, "I wish there was somebody to explain everything to us." And then when we get there, there's a few other people and this like big pundit, and he explains everything to us, like the whole story.
Mm-hmm.
And then after waiting for a while, he takes us in, and then into the there was two lines, the regular and the special, and he takes us into the special line, opens the barricade from the special line and takes me out, and my mom, and we walk along the side past the entire line around, and then there's an exit which is like the railing, there's only it's narrow for one line of people, and he takes us going in the wrong way and we're like walking like this, and then that hour-long line for the sanctum, he stops the entire line for a few seconds and puts me in front of it. So the sanctum was very powerful. It was such a magnetic pull. It was so powerful. Like, I just closed my eyes for 1 second and there was like an insurgence of energy in that magnetic pull. And the pundit there, he goes to the back, does something, and then he comes out with that long garland with the flowers on it, like my whole body, and he just puts it around me. Only me, nobody else got this.
Yeah.
He just like puts it around me, and then we left. The right way out of the line. And I'm just looking at my mom like, what just happened? And apparently my mom told me this, there was some guy behind us with his son, and he pointed at me and he looked at his son, he's like, you've seen Swami, are you happy now? This was so fascinating. I felt like this was a story from Yogananda, the autobiography of a yogi. You know, that's,
this is the autobiography of a yogi, Raj.
I don't know why that happened. I just,
because you received Ramana Maharshi's darshan. That's what happened.
Mm-hmm.
Think about that later.
I also met. I actually met another sannyasin, another Osho sannyasin. I didn't know he was that, but when I saw him, I saw this glow around him, like his. I don't know how or why. I mean, now I do, but. And then I was like, after talking to my mom, he waved at me, and then I went and talked to him, and it was. Great. So I felt like it was no accident I ended up there, because he told me that somebody, one of Osho's disciples, had told him that when Osho was asked, do you have any regrets in life, he had said no, but he wishes he got to have spoken to Ramana Maharishi. And I knew he was from Gangaji's side, right? Was that Ramana Maharishi?
Yes, he's Gangaji's guru's guru.
I remember that too when I was there, and I was like, this is no accident that I'm here, you know. But that's all for, no more crazy stories, except the caves that, where he lived first. That was also very powerful. And the monk. Yeah, but I gave him a banana. Those monkeys are good.
And on that note,
that's all.
Well, I loved hearing all that, except for the part about your mother, Masai. No, that was good too. That shows the power of Ramana Maharshi. That's a major miracle. He got your mother to be silent. Masai.
That's very funny. So I've been doing a lot of reading and viewing videos. I viewed some videos with Gangaji and I've been reading some Osho books online, which is a very slow process, so I haven't gotten the whole book, but I've been slowly reading. Can you hear me okay? But basically, I've been just having this transformation happening. I'm not really doing anything. But like, it seems like it just keeps, like, the realization of the life that I have just keeps giving me more and more gifts. And it's just getting to be more and more beautiful. And when, seriously, I just thought I was, you know, living with the devil my whole life. And now I'm just like, oh, maybe that's why that happened. And so, I think I forgot what I was going to say.
Well, you said
so
it.
So, for
you
example, I have no idea of what I'm doing, and I have no desire to make up what I should be doing. I'm just like, whatever. And I know that came out of realizing that I just can't control my life. I really tried hard, and I'm totally convinced I can't control it. So I have the luck of being open because of that. And then, you know, I used to hate the hurt of being alone. To me, actually, the first time I tried to kill myself in my 20s was because I was like, I cannot live the entire life of this people alone. It's just terrible. And it's been gone for years, but now it's a really, really not important to have another person to complete my sense of, I don't know what. I'm not searching for anyone to love me. It's not relevant somehow. And also, I always feel really guilty about not talking to my family. But when I said that the idea that people come into your life for a reason, and there's no reason why that couldn't include your family, I didn't feel guilty anymore. Not as guilty. And I realized there's no happy function in my life anymore. There's nothing in common except for genetics. And that's it. And, you know, my dad was not the most positive influence upon my life, but I realized the small gifts I got from my dad, and that really the blessing I got from my mom is that my mom was really smart, and she passed down her intelligence to me, and with that intelligence, I'm able to do what I'm doing today. But I, you know, I always admire her for her intelligence, because she's like ridiculously smart. But and I've created and all that stuff. But all these things are coming to me, and you know, I'm like, well, should I be doing something? And I don't know what I should be doing. So I'm just doing my normal life. I'm not really changing very much other than, you know, expanding my knowledge by listening to other satsangs and discourses. And I started reading some books. I have to admit, though, I'm not really good at meditating, because whenever I meditate, I start shaking profusely. So I'm a little bit, I don't want to say afraid, but you know, it's painful to just be shaking, and I just can't concentrate. All I'm trying to do is stop myself from shaking. But I did do some chanting meditation, the old chant with my son, twice this weekend. We did it Friday and Saturday. And that was fun, because also I had heads up focus and saying a chant. So I didn't have like crazy shaking. But if I do like a silent meditation, relaxation, the shaking just is like all over the place.
Yeah, so don't even go there for now. It's not the right thing for now.
Well, thank you. Because I was like, I can't meditate now, and I don't know what else to do, so I guess it's just not going to happen. I don't know what I would gain from it anyway. I used to think I would get peace from it. And I did get some peace from it, actually. And I did get some connection to that.
If it's not the right thing for now, then don't bother.
So what am I supposed to be doing, by the way? Just as a disciple, I mean, just keep going? Or?
No. The main thing you need to do is be willing, because what you're saying, in the simplest terms, what you're saying is things are getting better, three things. Things are getting better, I feel better, and this is succeeding. So the most important thing you can do is be willing to tolerate things getting better, be willing to tolerate and accept feeling better, not try to keep it or keep it happening. Be willing to tolerate feeling better and be willing to tolerate success.
Yeah.
Be willing.
I am a little afraid of success.
Yeah. So you can still be afraid of it, because willing to tolerate doesn't mean you have to change anything. You just have to add being willing to tolerate. So you can continue to be afraid of it, but nevertheless be willing to tolerate it.
Yeah.
That'll be the challenge. Can you tolerate? Are you willing to tolerate things getting better, you feeling better, and things succeeding? And sooner or later, it'll be hard to tolerate it.
I don't know what that means, but...
Yeah, you do. It's clear.
But the last part, the being able to tolerate was a little...
I said be willing to tolerate success.
So, and also be willing to tolerate the difficulty of tolerating?
No, what I said was, over time, at a later point, it will be hard to tolerate. There'll be enough success, things will have gotten even more better, and you'll feel even better, and it will just continue, and the longer that goes on, you'll get to a point where it becomes even harder to tolerate. Your job is to tolerate it, no matter how hard it becomes to tolerate it.
Okay. I see that. And I just have one last thing to say. Right after my initiation, my ego voice has been a lot quieter. And I'm also like, that's some bullshit ego stuff when it comes up. And I can not go into the suffering of what that voice is saying.
Good, but don't worry at all, because it'll get loud again at a later point.
Well, it has its moments, but I know that it's bullshit, that's all, because I think I've had it, I think suicidal thoughts, but I'm not suicidal, so I'm just like, let it say it's whatever it's saying, because that's not how I truly feel. My heart is very joyous right now. I just, even though physically I'm in pain almost every day, but the change in my life, even though it's profound to me, but it's not like, there was an explosion or anything, but it was so hard to stop wanting to kill myself. I mean, that was really, really hard. And that being lifted, and then it's like these entrails of other things are going up with it. And I don't have to protect myself so much anymore.
Great. So now you can switch from putting your energy into self-protection. You can put it into tolerating the good.
You mean like when it feels icky when somebody's nice to you? Because it sometimes does. Or if someone says they love you, you're like, ugh. Because your association with love is not, you know, pleasant.
Yeah, let it.
I don't have that strongly, but.
Yeah, let everything be, just like you're saying, nothing major has changed on the outside, but something is profoundly different on the inside. So you don't have to do anything. You don't have to change anything on the outside. You're saying, it doesn't seem like there's anything I have to change. If that's your view, then you're correct. What you'll have to do, what will be important to do, is to tolerate success. Tolerate things getting better. Tolerate feeling better. You've said three things. Things are getting better, I'm feeling better, and things are succeeding. In the most general way, I'm just generalizing what you said. That's the meaning of the things you said. Tolerate those.
Yeah, I hear what you're saying.
Good.
I feel very joyous right now, and I also feel very fearful of feeling joyous. And,
yeah, so. Yeah, so tolerate feeling joyous, because obviously tolerating feeling joyous means you don't get caught up in the feeling of wanting to run. Tolerate means you know that running is not the thing to do. You already know that, but I'm emphasizing it. Tolerate means accept success, accept feeling better, accept things getting better. Not as a way to keep them getting better, as a way to tolerate what's already the, as a way to enjoy what's already the case, so that you don't end up throwing it out the window, so that you don't sabotage it.
Yeah.
Tolerate.
Good
point. Tolerate. Tolerate the good things you're describing. Okay.
Very good point. Yeah.
Okay, well, I'm going to declare this youth convocation at an end.